Good morning and welcome to Prayer and Devotion on this Wednesday, February 23rd. And it is good to be with you this morning, starting off today with one of my favorite hymns, Because He Lives, and that is Carrie Underwood from her album entitled My Savior. So I hope you enjoyed that. I may be talking a little bit about it during our devotion this morning. So it's good to be with you this morning. Today we're looking at Mark 5. Actually, we're finishing up Mark 5 and returning to a story that we had taught, that we had started yesterday. But as you turn in your Bibles, let me say good morning, Barbara and Lisa. I'm glad you're here today, holding you in prayer. And Augusta and Macon, welcome. Praying for you this day. Good morning, Daniel and Priscilla. It's good to have you here, holding you in prayer as we start this day. And good. Sorry. Good morning, Lisa and Gail. I'm glad you're here, holding you in prayer as we start this day. And Yolette and Michelle, good to have you here, holding you in prayer. And Sheila and Blanca, I'm glad you're here too, praying for you as we start this day. Georgiana and Donna, good to have you here, holding you in prayer. And Augusta and Janet, welcome. Praying for you this day. Betty and Celia, I'm glad you're here, holding you in prayer, as well as Minda and Vinette. It's good to have you here also. Oh, I gotta keep scrolling down. Welcome, holding you in prayer, and Rosetta. Did I miss anyone? If I missed you, I'm so sorry. God did not miss you. And I am glad you are all here this day. So today we're looking at Mark 5. We're going to finish it up starting in verse 35. We're picking up the story of Jairus and his daughter. And I'm going to actually make some references back to yesterday's story as well. So if you'd like to open up your Bibles to Mark 5, my name is Cindy Stauffer. I am blessed to serve as a pastor at the United Methodist Church at New Brunswick on the corner of George and Liberty in the heart of the city of New Brunswick. And so I am glad that you have decided to get up this morning, or if you're watching later, that you've decided to watch this and root yourself into God's word and in this time of devotion today. So I'm glad you're here. So Mark 5, we've been walking through the Gospel of Mark, the good news, right? This is the good news, proclamation of God's good news for us. And today we're picking up a story that we began yesterday about Jairus. And I'm actually going to read for you we're going to start in 21 through 24, then we're going to hop over to 35, so we kind of get the full story. So this is Mark 5, 21. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be well and live." So he went with him. Now we're going to jump over to verse 35. While he was still speaking, some people came to the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. And when they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha cum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this, and then and told them to give her something to eat. So yesterday we talked about the woman in the crowd. First, Jesus is approached by Jairus, who is a man of power. He is a leader in the synagogue, and he knows that his child is on the verge of dying, and he begs Jesus to come, begs him. So we've got this story, and then we have a story of a woman who maybe isn't at the point of death, but she has been bleeding for 12 years, same length the child's life, and for the people of that time, and for us in some ways, blood is life. Blood is the very life, and so basically she has been bleeding and life has been going out of her for 12 years, right? She's a woman with nothing, okay? She's probably an older woman. So there's these two stories, the story of this young girl, 12-year-old girl, who is on the verge of death from a family of power and privilege, and a woman who has spent everything. She has no means, and she has literally been dying bit by bit, right? Estranged from the community, pushed away. The two stories are very different, but they are very similar, okay? And the similarity is this. Jesus has come to bring life out of places of death. That's the message for today. For the woman who was bleeding, estranged, had nothing, he offered her healing and returned her to the community, offering her a chance at life, life in Jesus, you know, new life, new possibility, new hope that she never had before. For Jairus, whose daughter in today's story, literally the community has said that she has no life in her, Jesus brings her from that place and brings life back into her, right? Through the faith of a father that believes, Jesus is able to bring life out of death. So what does that mean for us this day, right? So I'm gonna tell you a quick story. I'm sorry I'm rushing through the part of the scripture today, but many years ago, when I was young, probably 12 or 13, the age of this same young girl, my mother asked me to sing "Because He Lives" in church that Sunday. She would often wake me up on Sunday morning and say, "I need you to sing this song. It goes really well with my message." Of course, I do those things to my kids now. And so I sang in church, and honestly, I was so young, I didn't understand, you know, the depth of what music could do, and, you know, even really what I was singing, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. But that day, a woman who had never come to church showed up. You may have heard this story before, but if you haven't, it's a first time. If you have, it's a second time. But this woman came to church. She had been passing by the church, was really struggling in her life to believe that life was worth living, close to giving up her life. But she saw this church and she thought, well, maybe there's something there. And so she went to church that day. She snuck into one of the back pews. And this song was the song my mom had asked me to sing. And many years later, my mom told the story to me about how that woman, how that song spoke to her and turned her life around. In that, she realized that God loved her so much, that God had given his life for her, and that her life was worth living. Her life was worth living. And that day, that story became a story of how Jesus brings life out of death. Most of us are walking around through the world in a world that deals with death. You know, we experience things daily that have the power to take life away, literally and figuratively, spiritually, emotionally. But Jesus is about bringing life. Last week we talked about choosing life. Jesus is about bringing life out of places of death. This is what both of these stories are about. That Jesus has the power to bring life out of our places of death. Out of places of death in the world, out of our own personal places of death. Jesus can bring life again and again and again. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. And I know that life is worth the living just because he lives. That is such a powerful statement for us. Jesus is a life giver. All we need to do is to accept it, to remember that even the places in ourselves that feel most like life isn't there, that God is working through Jesus to bring life again. And that, my friends, is good news. So as we come into this time of prayer, I want to encourage you to this day and in this time of prayer, to have that melody, that message, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Let that be a mantra for you, a reminder for you this day, that our God is a God that is life-giving. Let us pray. God, we come before you today grateful, so grateful for the life that you pour out into us, into the places that we see impossibility, you bring new life. Into the places that seem like nothing is left, you bring abundance. Lord, we acknowledge that too often we have been about the work of death dealing in the world, giving up forgetting that you are making all things new. And so today, Lord, we lift up the places in our lives where we have lost hope. We lift up the places in our lives that are in such need of new life, new possibility, your promise. Help us, Lord, to see with your eyes this day, to trust and believe that because you live, we can face tomorrow, that all fear will be gone, and that life is worth living. Help us, Lord, this day to choose life, to choose you, to give ourselves into your hands, that you might make something new. We lift all of this up to you, Lord Jesus, as together we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Because he lives, I can face today and tomorrow. Life is worth the living. Let that be a message throughout your day, this day. God loves you, my friends, and so do I. Have a blessed day, and I'll see you back here tomorrow. Bye, friends. Oh, just a quick reminder, or just a quick message. I'm going to be in the Pocono Mountains tomorrow morning. I am praying that everything will go well and I'll be able to connect with you. But if something happens, I'm so sorry. I'm going to try it tonight. So hopefully everything will be okay. But just in case, I'm letting you know. I'll try to do an outside one so you can get to see the beautiful mountains tomorrow. I'm going to be at a continuing ed with some colleagues. So anyway, I will see you in the Poconos tomorrow. Bye, friends.